Hi everybody, today is Friday, September 27th, and after some reflections over the last week or so, we wanted to talk to you today. I'm here with Amy Bright, Assistant Superintendent for Elementary Education, and we want to talk a bit about our reflections on the feedback that we got from teachers. We hear you loud and clear about some of the frustrations and the challenges with lesson planning, and so we want to try to break that down a little bit today. So it's a very informal video for you, which I hope explains our efforts to dial this back to relieve some of the pressure and some of the strain on this work, but at the same time making clear that why we're doing this work. It's really important, I need to say this at the outset, it's really important that we set high expectations for all of our students and that there's consistency across the district. So in doing that, it's clear to us that schools are at different points in this experience. Some may have done this work over the last couple of years and some are new to this work. And so we were really thoughtful in working with our administrators just this past week, talking with all the principals who are in agreement with the plan that I'm about to present to you with Amy today. And also sharing this with all of our teachers, all of our educators from us, so that we're not looking to have this go through the principals and maybe there's different interpretations. We thought this might be the most helpful. That said, we will be coming around, Amy and I will be coming around along with the principals at the schools. We'll choose about three locations. I think that's probably easiest to do, and people can choose which dates work for them after school, and we can talk this through. We are not looking to make this a perfect lesson plan. We're not looking to make this submissions of this information to be absolutely perfect. This is messy work. It's work that we have to do together. We're gonna learn from it, and I expect that the feedback we'll continue to get as we do this work together, that we'll make even more changes along the way. So thanks for being patient with us. Again, we heard you, and we're gonna tell you a little bit now about what the expectations are to really try to dial this back a bit to make this something that you're not spending every waking hour doing, but yet it's really thoughtful and intentional for kids. So that said, let's talk a little bit about, Amy, maybe you could talk a little bit about these charts you put together.
Sure. From our conversations. So we thought we would try to capture the conversations that principals had regarding expectations. And so we can start with tier three schools. So that's Brophy, McCarthy, and Wilson. Brophy, McCarthy, and Wilson will continue to use the current planner that they've had in place for the past 2 years for reading and math. For writing, it should include, their lesson plan should include the standards written out, the content objectives, and the language objectives. And then starting in January, of course, you know, if there are some, I know at some schools they're ready now, but if they want to move to, the expectation would be that starting in January, we would be using the planner for the execution of writing plans as well.
All right, let me just pause you for a second. So the planner is already provided. People know what that is.
Yep.
And the standards written out, this came up as a feedback that I got about sort of the cutting and pasting exercise and all that. We had talked a little bit about maybe in the planning and thinking of this kind of a week at a glance, maybe having all the standards identified in one spot,
mm-hmm.
and then maybe could we just have them refer to the number so
yes.
in the document itself, mm-hmm. but we acknowledge it. So we're not having to do more cutting and pasting than is absolutely necessary, but that's okay.
No, it's like you said, this is not an exercise in compliance or perfection. So this
okay.
is not meant to create more work for a teacher, but instead an intentionality around how am I providing equitable access to high quality instruction for all students. And so they'll move to the use of that planner for writing by January. And then in science and social studies, the standards would be written out. You'd have the content and language objectives. We either do science or social studies over the course of the week. So you might have science lesson plans for that week, but then not social studies plans. And then for SEL, we're just requiring the topic. So you might be discussing the use of being in the green zone. That would just be the topic. Or a second step, lesson 12, that's the topic. And phonics, because it's a scripted program and we expect phonics to be taught every day within the phonics block based on time on learning, that will not be a requirement to include in the lesson plans.
Okay, and then this tier vocabulary you have mentioned here.
So
tier vocabulary is something we have to obviously identify. We're making sure that we're as inclusive as we possibly can be in these lessons. So, and how we modify. So this is...
Sorry to argue, tier vocabulary could be up the top where you had the standards before.
Okay.
So you have all the standards written out and then you're just referencing back. The tiered vocabulary, what tier vocabulary would you need for science, writing, reading, math, social studies over the course of the week?
Great, now talk us through how this looks. So this is tier three,
mm-hmm.
schools that are already familiar with this work. And let me just say, you know, we know teachers are planning lessons. Every teacher's coming in, every educator's coming into a classroom mm-hmm. with a planned lesson. We know that's happening. So we're trying to just not make it seem like a compliance task. So if they're doing lessons, if this is happening and they have it in a written plan book, because that's how they've been doing it for
you
the,
would
their career.
Snap a picture of that plan book and then I would say almost all elementary classrooms have, they have a plan book, they know what they're trying to do that week. The multivariate groupings that are listed up here, you might have a groupings chart of how you're going through your stations this week. You could snap a picture of that and then snap a picture of your plan book and upload those two documents. It's not meant to be a college lesson plan that you're scripting out every single piece. So if there's a task and the task is in a Eureka module, it's a specific page number that you're referencing, then you would write the page number. You're not writing down every single thing that's in that, that worksheet or that piece of the module.
Okay.
But it should be, the intent is that it's supposed to engage a conversation between you and your colleagues. And if I were to walk in and I'm coming in to watch a lesson, yeah, I can see the task and the task is aligned to that content and language objective. And I hear the tier vocabulary, being utilized correctly, and that's helping them gain access to the content and language objective and the standard. And so some people have said, okay, Amy, you've bought like Lucy Coggins, or you purchased Eureka, and those things were purchased before me, but that those are our tier one curriculum, so why do I need to write it out? Well, Lucy Coggins and the kids that you have, there might need to be other things involved in the planning process. There might need to be supplementary material. So those pieces all need to be taken into consideration when you're looking at what is the standard asking us to do and the depth of the standard. We're assessed on standards all the time. We're assessed on standards in iReady. We use that as a progress monitoring over the course of the year. We're assessed at the end of the year for MCAS on standards mastery. So those pieces need to be understood in order to make sure that what we're asking kids to do really meet the depth and breadth of that standard.
That makes sense. All right, so talk about the tier one, tier two
so
overall.
So tier one and tier two, although most if not all educators are having lesson plans already, we're asking them to be thoughtful about these five components that the research supports. So if you have your standard written out, you know the depth of the standard, then you can be fully aligned to what the content and language objective are. You might write the task and what you're asking children to do. Again, that multivariate groupings might just be your the snapshot of your groupings chart that's in your room. And assessment. I think assessment has maybe come under the perception of what we mean by assessment. We don't mean a test every day. I don't mean a worksheet every day. It might be thumbs up, thumbs down. It might be an exit ticket. It might be a written response. How do you know at the end of that lesson or at the end of that week or the end of that day that your students in your class understand the content objective and are on their steps to mastering that standard? And that's just a thoughtfulness that I think in talking with coaches and with teachers, and I think we all agree that that's a needed piece.
And this is work that already started when we started the work at Brophy, McCarthy, and Wilson.
Mm-hmm.
Over the last couple of years, we started with reading and math. So part of our thinking was, because we were asking for every subject, and that was kind of the strain, right?
Yep.
So we've started, the dial back, to use that phrase, here is to say, well, let's do what we did. And our thoughtful process was to say, well, let's just start with the tier one and tier two, with where we started with tier three.
Mm-hmm.
And that was at the expectations for reading and math. But the writing, the science, and social studies, here we're just looking for the standards, the content, and the language objectives, period.
Yep.
That's how we've dialed that one back. So hopefully that makes things a little easier. And again, the standards goes the same as what it was over here for the tier three schools. The standards can be highlighted at the top, and we'll present a what we think is a good solution document, but they can simply be bulleted as to making reference to it. Again, the whole purpose of all this is to making sure that we know the teachers know what tasks to use and what assessments to use. It's we want to make sure that we're tying it back to specific language and content objectives that tie back to standards. When we do that, we can ensure that there's a level of consistency of experience across the district. And then the SEL piece. We know that SEL also is the back. I keep referring to this as the backdrop,
mm-hmm.
right? If a child's coming to school, and we know that some of our schools struggle with this more than others, if a child's coming to school, they're dysregulated or they're not able to engage, none of what happens here actually is able to really happen well. So this has got to be, it's hard to say, what's the priority? Can it be reading? Can it be math? It's
going
to be SEL too.
Even if a student is regulated, when you're looking at SEL, the components of SEL that we've laid out for teachers in August and September's professional development days, you're not just talking about second step and zones. You're talking about the learning and life competencies and the tier one universal practices that kids need to have as learners, as adults, to access all of these things. So you're trying to be mindful of, I need to be organized. I need to advocate for myself. Those are learning and life competencies that are going to play out through the course of the school day. So even though you have an SEL block, thanks to the extra 15 minutes, then we'll be able to have a place that is mindful of how that block interacts with the rest of the day.
Perfect. And phonics, because it's scripted, we don't feel the need to have that as
nope.
one more
piece
of there. One of the conversations I had this week, As we were walking around getting feedback, so, you know, of course I heard at the school committee meeting and then talked to teachers and an FTA meeting, but also just walking, talking to principals, talking to teachers, pulling together a small cluster of teachers at one school and kind of brainstorming some of these concepts together. It was really helpful, but the most enlightening conversation was the one that I had with a special education teacher in the hallway around the need to say, well, when I plan the lessons, I work and I see how I'm going to make the accommodations with the classroom teacher. And to do that, it helps me to see the week at a glance. So we thought about maybe taking this as kind of a week at a glance. Mm-hmm. So it's not this feeling of, I have to do this every day, because if I, what happens if there's a snow day on a Tuesday, mm-hmm. or something with a fire drill and my ELA lesson, my language lesson is gone. It's going to get shifted. Now I have to go back into the drive and change it.
So this is not a
right?
lesson,
so
like you said, not a lesson in compliance. So if you look at an example, so we listed like what that example, a really rough drawing of what that would look like. So if I plan my skeleton out for the week, yeah, it's going to shift. It's going to be messy. You're going to have multiple and varied groupings. Maybe your groupings chart is out of how you're working through those stations or the rotations, and maybe you need to shift those. That's fine. Nobody, it's not a coming in and saying, oh, Bob, what you wrote for Tuesday isn't what you have.
Yeah.
It's meant to be a conversation starter, like, oh, how'd you get to back to Tuesday? What was the issue, or what were kids not understanding? Because that might be a grade level problem also. And so it's intentional in trying to get teachers to have conversations with each other and administrators to have conversations with teachers about the work and about student learning. And so, like you had said, all the standards might be cut and pasted or written up top, and the tiered vocabulary that you need to have kids understand for the week. And then down here, I might just reference the number of the standard.
Okay.
And put the task, and like I said, a picture of the multi and varied groupings. It might be a hyperlink in.
So if I'm a special education teacher or I'm a bilingual educator, I can come in here and see exactly what's gonna happen over the course of the week and plot it. Similarly, we've been working with our administrative team and teachers, more administrators than teachers on this for now, for the CBRs,
yep.
Right? So if I want to go in and really know that I'm going to observe a writing lesson, we're trying to get calibration across the district mm-hmm. on what good writing looks like or what a great lesson looks like. We can now kind of see when it's going to happen. So it's not going to be perfect, but it gives us a chance to calibrate across the district. And I think it's a hard message, because people are feeling this in different ways, depending on their comfort with this. And depending. So again, I think that for us going around to these meetings, teachers can come in and it's not going to be, it's going to be more like a Q&A. It's going to be more like a workshop with teachers who may be struggling to understand the why behind this work, and also just letting us remind everybody, you know, you're forgiven. This is work to just be, right? It's not going to be perfect. We're not going to be graded on this,
no. But
it gives an opportunity for principals to have meaningful conversations with teachers around what's happening in the classroom. Are kids achieving at the bottom, at the end of this? Look, I'm mindful of the burden on teachers, and we don't want to have that strain. You know, ideally this would be great to have on a Friday before the week, so you can, the specialists can get in there and plan, but I also know that, you know, a Monday gives some relief for teachers who do want to be thoughtful over the weekend on their own time.
And,
so you
and
can
Monday
always
allows,
get in earlier.
Well, Monday allows for that special educator or the English language learner teacher to go in and say, okay, let me give you some ideas for modifications, or let me work with you to understand that better. It also gives the administrator a place, okay, so you don't have language objectives, tell me why.
Yeah.
You don't understand how to write language objectives. Let me do that PD. Oh, a whole grade level is having an issue with that. Well, then during the literacy team time, if that's where you're struggling, then maybe some of the focus of the literacy team time can be, let's really focus on what we mean by language objectives and why we have them and what they look like when they're really powerful and intentional. Or if it's content objectives, well, okay, in math team time, maybe I'm going to have the math coach unpack that with you about what this one standard that maybe we notice from some data points we are not doing well with kids in that standard. Why? Do we understand the depth of the standard? Are our tasks really aligned and asking kids to do the work that is required to show mastery of that standard? And so these are just, I would say, conversation starters. And so no one's going back and going, well, what you did on Monday isn't reflected here. Because the hope is that next year, this is going to be the heaviest lift. Because next year, you'll already have the skeleton.
That's
and
right.
You'll go, you know what? Monday didn't work. And I write myself some notes, just like you would when you're regularly planning, as you've been doing. So this is a more intentional approach.
I like it. So I guess I don't know if there's anything more to be said about this. It may be helpful if we create this template for teachers, but we'll wait to hear feedback on mm-hmm. that. And again, we'll set up, unless anything else you want to add to that.
I think the only other thing that I would add is, because we've heard like, oh, we all have to be doing these, like you have to be doing the exact same lesson as I'm doing on the exact same day. That would be if we had the exact same kids. So there's opportunities, there's a pacing guide for a reason, because we want to make sure that as a district, we've set expectations that all the standards are covered within a given year. So we say that, say, module 6 should be covered between this date and this date. But what happens between those two dates? you have the autonomy to say, you know what, lesson seven didn't really work for me because my kids didn't need that strategy. And so I'm going to condense lesson six and lesson seven. So the autonomy lives within the pacing guide, but it lives within the pacing of the unit or the module. But you still have to start and end within the parameters so that we make sure that we're giving equitable experiences to kids throughout the course of the school year.
Great. So I hope, and you know, this is complicated. It was complicated for us to think about a reflective way to make this where we're not undoing the work we've been doing for the last couple of years and seeing some gains. At the same time, so we just can't scrap it all, but at the same time, as much as I'd like to see us do it all now, and because there's an urgency of need and time, I also am attentive to that. That's a real burden for us, and we need to dial that back. So I'm acknowledging that, and I hear you. So we hope this is a better way to move, to shift this kind of expectation, but still to keep the expectations high, because we want every single child to achieve in this district. That is the expectation. And to get there without a roadmap doesn't seem practical to me. It doesn't even seem possible to me. So to make that roadmap is as least burdensome as possible, we hope this gives some relief to that. So again, this is pretty complicated stuff. It's pretty hard to wrap your brain around. It is for me anyway. I've had to go through this a number of times with Amy to understand it. And I just want you to know that we have heard you. I appreciate all the work that you're doing to get this right for our kids. And know that it's okay to make mistakes with this. It doesn't have to be perfect. It can be a screenshot of a lesson plan. It can be things that are crossed off. We're just looking for consistency of experience across the district. And we can't think of any other way to do this besides watching it all and engaging our teachers in that process. So I hope you continue to be collaborative with us. We're going to get some dates out on the calendar. I'm going to work through. I had a conversation with the FTA leadership on this, and I'll work through the FTA leadership to make sure we have some dates at various locations, and we can actually have this as a working conversation with you, and make this hopefully feel a whole lot better than it might feel right now. So I hope you have a time on this long weekend to enjoy some time with your family. Thanks very much for watching.
Thank you.